Now, what is the reason for that? It is simply the reason. First, I'll just tell you the reactions which are involved. See, when K will react with water, it will lead to the formation of KOH. And along with that, what we get? H2. I think I missed in a general reaction. So you need to write that they produce hydrogen gas. So similar way, they are producing hydrogen gas. When we are talking of sodium, again, it will be forming sodium hydroxide with H2. But when we are talking about calcium and magnesium, they will also form their respective hydroxides. But the formula is going to be different because their valency is different. And moreover, they will react with water on heating. That means they react with somewhat boiling water. And when we react them with steam, that is the aluminium, zinc and iron, what do we get? We get these products. I'll just write it for you. Then I'll be explaining you. See, what do we get? Actually, in this case, again, it is O, not H2O. What happens in this case? See, when a few metals, which as I've told you, aluminium, zinc and iron, when they react with steam, they do not form their hydroxide. Because in superheated steam, the oxygen content is too high and moreover, their hydroxide are not so stable as compared to their oxides. So what they do? They react with steam, but they lead to the formation, instead of hydroxide, they lead to the formation of their oxides. Just look at the board, aluminium form, it's, instead of hydroxide, it is forming Al2O. And instead of Zn, this thing, zinc hydroxide, it is forming ZnO. And even in case of iron, it is forming Fe3O4. One question you often get in paper, that what happens when iron react with steam? As you know, when they react with steam, you will be so well versed with this concept as I'm explaining you again. So what you're going to write in the question, you'll say, yes, it will react with steam and it forms, you can say, the oxide instead of hydroxide. But you know, what is the major mistake what the children do actually? Instead of forming the Fe3O4, they form Fe2O3. So you should know that this is an important the question, that iron will form its oxide. Obviously it is going to form oxide, because any metal when react with steam, it form it oxides. But instead of forming its this Fe2O3, it forms it Fe3O4. And you need to know that, because you get so overconfident with these equations that yes, they are just forming the hydroxides, or you just know that it is forming the oxide. So you just the mistake in this part, instead of forming Fe3O4, you form Fe2O3. So just in close in your mind that you need to form Fe3O4, not Fe2O3. And this is the question which you often get in paper. So just be thorough with this answer. Now, there are few metals which do not react with water in any case. And what are those? The metals which are placed below hydrogen, copper, mercury, silver, gold, platinum, they do not react with water in any case. Now, what is the reason behind? See, suppose I am taking an example of water. Or what I will do, I will take an example of metal, then I will convert this general metal into copper. So what happens? If I want that metal react with hydroxide, so that means if on reacting with hydroxide, it needs to displace hydrogen. So that means it has to displace hydrogen. And how it can displace now? As we know, it can take the place of hydrogen just by reducing the hydrogen. Means it has to donate the electrons to hydrogen, and the hydrogen will be taking that electron and just will be form the ion, it will be forming a molecule. That means it has to displace, and in order to displace, it has to reduce hydrogen. And the condition which is necessary to reduce is this metal should possess the capability that it should be able to donate electron, and moreover, it should have the capability of displacing the hydrogen, right? And the criteria which is used for displacing, you know that the more reactive displaces, the less reactive. And as you can see it from the reactivity series, so any metal which comes under the hydrogen is less reactive than hydrogen. And you know that the less reactive metal cannot displace the more reactive one. So as they are placed below, so that means they are not able to displace hydrogen, they are not able to reduce hydrogen. surgeon, and if in that case they are not able to displace or reduce, so that means they are not going to react with the hydroxide, because any metal or element which need to react with hydroxide of water need to displace hydrogen, and for that displacement the reduction is an important part, and so that means the reactivity of that the metal which need to displace should be high. So similarly, if I take this, convert this example of metal into copper, so can displace this hydrogen? Exactly no, because it is placed below hydrogen, and we know that the metal which is below hydrogen has the reactivity lesser than the hydrogen, so how can it reduce it? It cannot displace, it cannot reduce, so that is why the reaction do not occur. So this is the reason that why copper, mercury, silver, gold, platinum do not react with even superheated steam. They do not react with cold water, neither with the boiling water, nor with the superheated steam, because their reactivity is too low that they cannot displace or reduce the hydrogen in order to combine with the hydroxide ion. So this is the, you can say, the thing which you get, which you may get in the question paper, that which metals react with hot water, or which react with steam, or which do not react, and what are the reasons behind. So you should be well versed with the concept. Now, just look on the non-metal part. So what happened? Non-metal, when react with water, in a similar way, because if it is applicable for metal, so it is applicable for non-metals as well. That if any substance need to react with hydroxide, it needs to displace hydrogen. And in order to displace hydrogen, it has to reduce hydrogen. And for reduction, what is needed? That means the metal which element which need to take its place should possess the electron, or it should has the power to show oxidation. And do you think that non-metals can donate electrons? No, they cannot donate electrons, because they are themselves electron acceptors. They are themselves deficient in electrons. So how can they have an extra electron to which they can donate to hydrogen? So as they don't have any extra electron which they can donate it to anybody, not even the hydrogen, I'm talking about the any substance, they cannot donate, because they are electron acceptors. So that means it is simple that the non-metals do not react with water in any condition, because they do not have the tendency to lose electron, and as they don't have any such tendency, so that means they cannot displace hydrogen. So the overall reaction is going to be no reaction. So this is what the reaction of non-metals with the water. Now, one question which is striking in my mind, you may get in a question paper, that there are few non-metals which you can store in water, right? So if you get a question like this, that's yes, this suppose you get a question that this or this non-metal can be stored in water, or it can be metal also, right? It is applicable similarly for the metal. So suppose you get the question that this metal or this non-metal is stored in water, and why it is stored in water without any apparent action. So the answer should be directly that yes, it can be stored in water with apparently no reaction, because it do not react with water. That means it do not displace hydrogen, cannot reduce hydrogen, and moreover it remains unaffected, right? So this is the reason that any substance is stored in water. So this is the second property, that is the reaction of metal with water. Now we'll be taking up the third reaction, that means the third property of metal and the non-metal. I think you are familiar with the reaction of metal with oxygen and reaction of non-metal with oxygen, and you are also familiar with the reaction of metal with water and the reaction of non-metal with water. Now we'll be taking up their reaction with the acids. I think you can recall easily that acids are of two types, dilute and concentrated. What are the dilute acids? Dilute acids are actually those in which the the amount of water is high, and concentrated acid is that in which the amount of the water is less. That means the salt content is more, solvent content is less. But now what I am considering in the reaction is we are considering the dilute acids. That means the acid in which the water content is high. So reaction of metal with dilute acids, and similarly we'll be taking this property for the non-metals as well. So what happens? See, this is metal, This is any dilute acid. You know that acid are those substances which has H in them, and when they dissolve in water, they can directly give their hydrogen ions. So this is what I indicated with the general acid formula, that is HX. So what happens when metal react with HX? This M reacts with X, form the respective salt, and plus it leads to the evolution of hydrogen gas. Again, the formula varies, as the, you know that now you are familiar with it, that the formula actually varies with the change in the valencies of the different metals. Suppose I have sodium, and the acid which I am taking in an example is hydrochloric acid. So that means sodium is going to react with chlorine. So what kind of formula we are going to get? You all know it is NaCl, that is our table salt, sodium chloride. Now I am doing this reaction with some other metal, say calcium. Again, I have taken the hydrochloric acid. So again, calcium is going to react with chlorine. So what I am going to get? I am going to get calcium chloride, that is the salt again, not the table salt, but specifically the salt, right? Calcium chloride plus hydrogen. Similarly, if I take some other acid like sulfuric acid, so again Mg is going to react with the sulfate ion. As if you just get confused in doing the chemical reaction, what you do, just take a pencil, and when you are writing the reaction, just write their valencies as a superscript, and just after doing the reaction, just rub it out. It will be more convenient for you to do, right? So see, as I'm doing it for you, Mg is 2 positive, hydrogen positive, sulfate 2 negative. So Mg is going to react with sulfate. After interchanging their valencies, what we get? We get magnesium sulfate, MgSO4 plus hydrogen gas. So that means in this way we can react many metals with the acids, that is the hydrochloric acid, nitric acid, or the sulfuric acid, or the sulfurous acid. So that means we can just react what we are going to get in all of them. We are going to get the respective salt, and along with that the evolution of the hydrogen gas. And like if somebody asks you that if I give you an acid HCl, and I just give you you can say the piece of sodium, and I ask you that just show me that the reaction take place or not, or how you can indicate it. So what you're going to do, just react Na with HCl, or just put Na into HCl. What will you observe? You will observe the evolution of H2 gas, and you know that the H2 gas burns with a pale blue flame in the presence of oxygen. And moreover, what is the sound? And if that when it get mixes with air, what is the sound of the hydrogen gas? It is the popping sound. So just the evolution of the hydrogen gas indicate that yes, the reaction has taken place. So whenever you get a question like that, and somebody asks you that, just show the reaction take place or not. So just consider the gases which are involved in it, and you must be familiar with the test of the gases. Like it is a CO2 which turns lime water milky. There is a hydrogen sulfide gas which has a smell of rotten egg like. There is a sulfur dioxide which has a burning smell. There is ammonia which has a pungent smell, right? And even as I told you, there is a hydrogen gas which burns with a pale blue flame, and when it comes in contact with air, it produces the popping sound. So this is how you're just going to indicate that wherever it is needed. Like in this, we were just considering the hydrogen. In some other example, we'll be getting some other gases. So you should be familiar with the test as well, just to indicate that yes, the reaction has taken place. So this is how, just coming to the topic what we were discussing. So when metal react with acids, they form the respective salt, and along with that hydrogen gas is evolved. Now the there is an important question that do you think that the copper is going to give this kind of reaction? Suppose I'll write a reaction with for you. Do you think that copper is going to react with it? So what is the basic phenomena which is involved in the reaction? That means copper is going to react with chloride, obviously the chloride ion, and it need to displace the hydrogen ion, right? So what it is going to do? So can you think, do you think that the copper can reduce the hydrogen? No, it cannot reduce. Again, the same reason, because it is to reduce, it has to be more reactive than hydrogen. And as we know in the reactivity series, it is placed below hydrogen. So how it can reduce it? No, it cannot reduce in any case. But if we consider the concentrated one, so the reaction may occur at specific temperature and pressure conditions. But when we're talking about the dilute acids, the reaction do not take place. The same reason is for the mercury, silver, gold, platinum, I mean the all metals which has the low reactivity than the hydrogen, because they need to displace hydrogen and for that they should be more reactive. So then only the reaction will occur, as it was occurring in these cases. But in the metals which are placed below hydrogen, it will not be occurring for those metals, right? So this is the reaction of metal with the dilute acids. Now again with non-metals, so what was the reason when I just made non-metal reacted with water? So you just wrote that there is no reaction because again it needs to displace hydrogen, and non-metals are electron acceptors. They cannot donate electrons, so they cannot reduce this thing, the hydrogen. The same thing they have to do when they react with dilute acid, that means they need to displace hydrogen. So they cannot displace hydrogen because, as I've told you before also, they are electron acceptors. So how can they give their electron to an hydrogen? So how can they reduce hydrogen? So that means they cannot reduce, they cannot displace, so that means the no reaction take place. So this is the reason that non-metals do not react with dilute acid, right? So there is one more property which we'll be discussing. The reaction of metal with hydrogen. So what happens when metal react with hydrogen? It forms metal hydride, right? For example, sodium plus hydrogen. See, whenever the hydrogen is combining with metal, as you know, the hydrogen has the valency 1 and electronic configuration 1. So it may need one electron to complete its octet, or it may give its electron back. So that means it can exist as H positive as well as it can exist as H negative. So when it combines with metal, it exists in a negative ion, that means H negative, because metals are electropositive, and according to you can say the tendency, the metal, it is not so electropositive, so it behaves in an electronegative manner, that it exhibit the valency of H negative. So what happens? It forms NaH. Suppose if I just consider for magnesium, so what it will be forming? It will be forming again Mg2 positive, H negative, MgH2. So similarly, it will form the hydride, and you know the nature of the hydride which it forms with the metal is always going to be ionic hydride. The same reason, because metals are electropositive, and if we compare the electropositive character of hydrogen with the metals, it is too less. So that is why the it behaves in an electronegative manner. It is just crisscross with the H negative ion. So it their behavior is that they are totally ionic hydride. That means there is a condition in which only the ionic bond is formed. Now when we talk of non-metals with hydrogen, so non-metals when combined with hydrogen, so they form non-metal hydride. As you get to see, lot of hydrocarbons existing in nature, CH4, C2H6, C2H2, likewise so many. So you can see the carbon is the non-metal which form different types of hydrides, and you know what is the nature of the hydride? It is typically a covalent hydride. That means the sharing of electron is formed, because hydrogen is electronegative nature, and moreover we know that non-metals are electronegative in nature. So electronegative when combines with an electronegative just lead to the formation of the covalent bond. That means the sharing of the electrons. So this is what the properties that the metal with the hydrogen, metal hydride; non-metal with the hydrogen, non-metal hydride; ionic hydrides, typical covalent hydrides, right? So this is the reaction with the hydrides. One more property we'll be discussing, but that will only will be for metals, not for the non-metals. Now what is that? It is, again I'm repeating, this property is only for the metals, not valid for the non-metals. Reaction of metal with metal salt solutions. So what happens? See, here is a metal, right? And here is some metal salt. What I'll write, I'll just make it M dash, just to indicate that this is a different metal and this is a different metal. So what is going to happen when we react with this kind of, like if there is a reaction of this kind, you know that what shuffling can occur in this reaction. That means just the metals can interchange their position. That means this can just come this side and this can just come, means they can just exchange their positions. And if we want that they should exchange their position, that means there is a displacement reaction. You know that, see, this is a element and this is a compound, and you know that the reaction between the element and a compound is always a displacement reaction, right? But what is the criteria behind this reaction to occur? It is that this metal should be more reactive and this metal should be less reactive, then only the reaction is going to take place. For example, I'll state an example. See, if we have Zn plus CuSO4, so in here this Zn is my M and the Cu is my M dash, right? So for the reaction to occur, what is the criteria should be fulfilled? It is that this zinc should be more reactive and this should be less reactive, then only the reaction is going to take place, right? Now from where do you get to know that which is more reactive, which is less reactive? Yes, you are right, from reactivity series. So if we'll just see that reactivity series, and we know that the metals which are present at the like the top is more reactive and as compared to the metals which is present down. So as we look in the reactivity series, zinc is placed above and copper is placed below. So that means zinc is more reactive and copper is less reactive. That means our criteria is fulfilled. So obviously the reaction is going to take place. So that means zinc is going to react with this sulfate, and again this copper is going to get reduced. So this is ZnSO4. Now all the reaction all the reaction which involve the metal with the metal salt solution, criteria should be this should be more reactive and this should be less reactive. Suppose I just get a question, Cu plus ZnSO4, do you think the reaction is going to take place? No, it is not going to take place because it is less reactive and it is more reactive. So the reaction takes place only when a more reactive metal displaces the less reactive metal from its salt solution. One more question I just want to discuss with you is that, suppose I give you one container and I ask you that it contains a blue color solution. You will indicate that blue color solution as CuSO4. And what I'm doing, I'm adding a rod of zinc to it. What is going to happen? So what you will be asked for, so see, if you get a question that knife is dipped, nail is dipped, or ribbon is dipped, so we are not concerned with the forms, we are just concerned that what kind of what material of this substance is used. So as I told you, zinc rod is dipped in CuSO4, so you should be just concerned what is the material of the rod. So that means it is a zinc. So just react with Zn plus CuSO4 and just show that this and this, and you'll get a question like this: what will happen to the rod and what will happen to the color of the solution? So you know that the rod is going to dissolve because it will now form the solution that is ZnSO4. So what you're going to write, that as a result this reaction take place, rod is going to dissolve, and if somebody asks you about the color of the solution, so you're just going to write the color of the blue color is going to fade, because blue color was due to CuSO4, and now we don't have any CuSO4, we have ZnSO4 solution. So that means blue color just fade out, turns into a greenish kind of color, because greenish kind of color is indicated by the zinc sulfate. So this is how you're going to answer. And suppose I just give you a question that copper coin is dipped in AgNO3 solution. What will happen to the coin and what will happen to the color of solution? In a similar way, you are going to write Cu plus AgNO3, more reactive, less reactive. So displacement, CuNO3 whole twice plus Ag. That means the copper coin is just going to dissolve, and the color of the solution will start turning blue because it leads to the formation of copper nitrate, which is blue in color. So this is how you are going to just attempt the chemical